All right. Well, so I really wish that we would have taped last week because we kind of did a whole overview on Romans chapter 6. And so tonight we're going to be getting into Romans 7, a good portion of it. But we have actually a couple of people here tonight that weren't here. I'm not going to go through all of Romans 6, but I would like to at least explain to you that Romans chapter 6 explains basically what you could say the mechanics of our salvation. What happened to me on the day that I got saved? And to be perfectly honest with you, for at least 12 years I was a Christian and didn't have a clue about the information that I'm going to talk to you about tonight. And so therefore I struggled, because if I was going to basically put in a nutshell what Romans chapter 6 means to me, it would be all about the object of my faith. Where do I keep my faith? Where do I place my faith? If you don't have a Bible, we have King James Bibles on the back. And to be honest with you, if I saw somebody without a Bible, I would probably just stop right now until everybody got up and got a Bible, because I think that you need to put your eyeballs on the scripture, especially when we get into Romans 7. Now, once again, just like I'm not going to make everybody sign a membership card, I'm not going to make you get up and go get a Bible. I'm just letting you know, when we get into Romans chapter 7, we need to look at it closely, and we need to make sure that we're understanding and we're all on the same page. Okay? All right. So in Romans chapter 6, once again, the mechanics of our salvation. And so what happened in the spiritual realm when you gave your life to Jesus? Do you remember that day? Do you remember where you were? Do you remember who told you about Jesus? Maybe not the first time, but do you remember the time you responded to the gospel? You know, where were you? Who was it that had been planting seeds in your life? And who was it that had told you how to pray and to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Well, it was on that day that a miracle happened. Whether you knew it or not is another story. But if you look at Romans chapter 6, verse 3, we're just going to start there. It says, "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life." We talked about that word, "know ye not." And what it said, what it basically was asking was the question is, were you ignorant? Did you not understand this? Has anybody never taken the time to explain this to you? Okay? And so what he's explaining now is that whenever the believer was saved, he was placed or baptized into Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's why Paul said, "We preach Christ crucified." And it's a stumbling block to the Jew. It's foolishness to the Greek. Because you see, the Grecian mind was intellectual. The Grecian mind was philosophical. And to say that you're going to find life through death makes no sense whatsoever. But in God's eyes, the wages of sin is death, and the giving of the sinless one to pay the penalty for the wages of sin brought life to humanity. Amen? And so what we see is the situation that, did you not know that you were baptized? And so once again, the word baptized meaning immersed or placed into something else. You were, the English word for whenever we hear baptized, we automatically think of water. But in reality, in the Greek, it doesn't mean that. It means to be, and I don't have time really to break down and give you other scriptures. We've done that at least 3 different times. I wish we would have taped it, but we didn't. But I want you to know that literally what it means is to be, well, let me just use one example. Jesus said to the sons of thunder, he whenever they said, "Can we sit at your right hand when you come into your kingdom?" Y'all remember that scripture?
Yes.
Jesus said, "Can you be baptized with my baptism?" Mm-hmm. Well, Jesus was already water baptized. Mm-hmm. They were already water baptized. What Jesus was talking about was he was about to be baptized or immersed into the cross. And what he was saying is, "Can you be baptized with my baptism?" He says, "Well, you will be baptized with my baptism." Because the truth is that in the mind of God, when the believer places faith in Christ, that he's the promised one, and what he did for you at the cross, the Holy Spirit baptizes you. Amen. I did it last week and I'll do it again. Here you were, born like Adam, broken and dead. That's why he's all crooked, because he's broken and he's dead like Adam. That's why his eyes are all X'd out. You were born broken and dead like Adam. You were born with a sinful nature. The word sin, this is really just kind of like a review in a certain sense. The word sin in Romans chapter 5 verse 20 through Romans chapter 6 is used, if I'm not mistaken, 19 times, and only once is it used as a verb. So every other time it's used as a noun and is descriptive of the sinful nature, that which you received from Adam, the root of sin that produces actions of sin, or the fruit of sin. The root of sin produces the fruit of sin. And so when you were born of Adam, you were born the first time with you still have a sinful nature, but it was active. It was active and it was ruling and reigning. And so the first time you're born of Adam, you're born broken and dead. But when you heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, and at the right time when you received it from your heart, you got to understand it in your head, but then you got to believe it in your heart. And when you believed it in your heart, you don't have to know a lot to get saved, by the way. I just have to tell you that you really don't. You have to believe, though. You have to believe that you're a sinner. You can't go into this thing thinking you're all right.
Amen.
You can't go into this thing thinking that everything's okay. You have to know that you're a sinner and that you're all undone and that you got a problem and that you need a Savior. And then you have to believe that Jesus is the right one.
Amen.
Then you have to believe that what Jesus did at the cross is what you needed for him to do for you. You might not be able to process all of that information, but you know what? When the Holy Spirit starts dealing with your heart, you know, I need to let you know that I'm a sinner, Lord, and I need you to do a work on the inside of my heart. Amen?
Amen.
Well, wherever you were that day, that night, whenever that happened, then what happened in the spiritual realm? I want you to see what God saw. I mean, I'd stand up on this pulpit and I'd peer down if I thought that I wouldn't break it. I probably just did. But that's what God would have done. He's peering down and he's watching you whenever, at that moment, that climax of your life, whenever that took place. He's peering down in the spiritual realm. You can't see what's going on, but in the mind of God, he's like, oh, another one's about to do it. Another one's about to believe and put faith and trust in the plan that I've written from ages of old, from times past. And it's the moment that you did it, the moment that your heart opened up and said, yes, Jesus, come into me, come, give me your life, forgive me of my sin, the Holy Spirit took you and he baptized you into Christ, where you became one with him in his death and his burial. And even as he was raised from the dead, you too should walk in newness of life. That's what happened in the spiritual realm. And if it happened to you, then if it was anything like what it was for me, when I stood up, it was like a burden of guilt had rolled off my back.
Yeah.
Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Hallelujah, man.
Yeah.
A burden of guilt rolled off my back. Did you not know that those of you who were baptized or made one with Jesus in his death and his burial and his resurrection from the dead, that you two should walk in newness of life.
Thank you, Jesus.
You became one with him.
Thank you, Jesus.
Planted with him. Resurrected with him.
Amen.
Amen. And then we went on to say that, you know what? That's what happened. You didn't really have to know much really to get saved.
Right.
But in order to walk with God, you got to learn some things.
Amen.
Because what happened for me, I'm just going to be honest with you. I was doing a lot of bad stuff whenever I first got saved. And look, nobody even had to tell me. I knew immediately fornication was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Wrote a letter to my little sister. Big old long letter. Fornicators will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Mm-hmm. And she sent something back and she said, you're in trouble then, dude. And, you know, because to her, she didn't understand what I was trying to say, but she knew who I was. She knew how bad I was. Drinking, I knew. 2 weeks, ain't touched a drop. Done. It's over. Nicotine, I used to shove a dip in a can of half a dip in my lip every day. Done. 2 weeks, went back out on that boat without none of that stuff. Talking about Jesus, man. Jesus showed up in my heart. Hallelujah. He changed me. Next thing you know, I go to church. He said, the best thing that you ever did was give your heart to Jesus. Now you got some stuff you got to do, son.
Yeah.
And without understanding it, and that's why this is going to transition into Romans 7, I began to change the object of my faith.
Mm-hmm.
I began to change the object of my faith from Jesus Christ. Never did finish my stick man. Jesus Christ and him crucified. See, and here's the baptism. I became one with him in his death and his burial. And even as he was raised from the dead, I too should walk in newness of life. Now I have a new position. And it was faith that brought me in. Does that make sense?
Amen.
You realize that faith brought you into the kingdom of God. Faith in what? Faith in that.
Yes.
Am I right or wrong?
Amen. Amen.
Faith in what Christ has done brought you into the kingdom of God. So therefore, what is it that brings you out of the kingdom of God? Because you're not going to hear Baptist theology from me in the sense of unconditional eternal security. I believe in eternal security, but I don't believe it's unconditional. And so the question is, where does the rubber meet the road? Where is the middle ground? Because you go to some Pentecostal churches around here, and it's like, you did the one sin that the preacher don't do, and now you're going straight to the devil's hell. Well, hold on a second. Time out. What got you in?
Faith.
Faith in what? Jesus Christ and him crucified. What does that even mean? That's the covenant of God. God had a covenant, an agreement that he made with mankind. You're a sinner. You're separated from my presence. I have a plan, an agreement, a covenant that I'm willing to offer unto you. And what I'm offering is ultimately I'm going to give you my son. I'm going to foreshadow it for you through a man named Abraham. That's why you got to read your Bible so you know the characters that we talk about. Amen. Through a man named Abraham. Hallelujah. I'm going to make a covenant through a man named Abraham 2,000 years before Jesus will ever show up. I'm going to make a promise in him. I'm going to make a nation through him. And through him, this nation that I made through Abraham, I'm going to give you the promised one, the sinless one, and he's going to die on the cross for your sin. Hallelujah. And whenever you put your faith in that, you're going to become a new creation in Christ. Your sin is going to be paid for. The old man's going to die and a new man's going to be resurrected.
Amen.
And if you learn how to keep your faith in that, the old man stays dead.
Amen.
And the new man learns to resurrect to newness of life.
Yes.
Not talking about sinless perfection. Mm-hmm. There was only one that ever walked a life of sinless perfection. So I don't want to lose my train of thought and not finish what I was trying to say about unconditional eternal security. There has to be a healthy balance between the fact that just because you messed up yesterday, that you're not automatically going to hell today.
That's right. Thank you, Lord.
Versus you just do whatever it is that you want to do and believe that God's grace is going to get you through.
Mm-hmm.
No. God's plan of salvation is built on covenant. And he said, because I could find no one greater to swear by, I swore by myself. God swore by himself. Jesus was the representative of heaven that became man and represented mankind. Amen. All of us in Adam became sinners. Those of us in Christ become saints. He was our representative man. He represented heaven. He represented mankind. And he was the sacrifice that sealed the deal. So now we're in covenant with God. God doesn't break covenant. What will happen, though, is that if you allow sin into your life and you allow it to continue in your life, it will slowly begin to erode the root, the soil that holds the root system, and it will bring destruction to your faith. You may not even realize when your faith is destroyed. Your faith, you understand what I'm getting at? Like the Lord said, there will be many on that day that will come unto me and say, Lord, Lord, didn't we do this? Didn't we do that? And in reality, he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. And so the truth of the matter is this, is that I believe that there's some people who think they're saved and really aren't saved. They believed with their head, but they never believed with their heart. And then I believe that there's people that have allowed doors to be opened and sin came in. And they weren't able to control it. And with time, it began to destroy their life. And ultimately, it could destroy their faith and ultimately destroy their soul.
Amen.
But at the same time, God is merciful. And I need to tell you something. He's not looking for a reason to get rid of you. He's looking for a reason to hold on to you. He loves you enough to send, hallelujah, his only son to die on the cross for your sin. But I wanted you to see that you were baptized into Christ. Then it says in verse 11, it says that you need to reckon yourselves. Chapter 6, verse 11. It says you need to reckon yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So God wants the word, the concept of reckon means you need, basically we're just going to break it down and make it easy. Okay, we're not going to get into all the words on this. You need to believe about you what God says about you.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
God says about you that the old man that was born of Adam died in Christ, was buried in Christ, and that a new man has been resurrected in Christ. And now he said it, and so you and I need to learn how to believe it.
Amen.
That's why I started this off. I mean, I didn't do it intentionally, but when I said object of your faith, object of faith. Now, I don't know what kind of preachers you listen to. I don't know if you've ever heard anybody even talk about that before. To me, faith was always just kind of like an abstract concept. But what I'm trying to talk to you about is the faith. Do you know that there's a difference between the noun faith and a verb faith?
Yes.
The noun faith represents the covenant, the faith. We're all in the faith. Verb faith is daily me having to place my faith in the faith, the plan of God. Does that make sense? So you have faith, but you've got to, you're also in the faith. Amen. And these things matter for us to understand this so that we can properly understand the gospel. And you may not walk out of here tonight feeling like you understood everything I said. That's okay. You keep coming back. You keep reading the Bible time and again, every day, each service, you're going to learn a little bit more. Amen. And we're going to walk together and we learn together and we grow together. All right. So, but number one, you got to know it. First, you were ignorant. Did you not know? Then now that you know it, you've got to start believing about you what God says about you. And then he says right here, let not sin therefore reign in your body, that you should obey it in its lust. Neither yield your members or your body parts as instruments, that's verse 13, which means weapons of warfare, of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. So just as in the past, when you were under the influence of your Adamic birth, and the sinful nature was ruling and reigning in your life, and you were offering your body parts as weapons of warfare for the kingdom of darkness. Y'all know what I'm talking about? I mean, I don't know what you did in the world, but I was kind of like, I help bring destruction in people's lives in a lot of different ways. I mean, I'm not going to sit here and spell it out because it's just too much. It's just a mess. You know, it hurts too bad to talk about all the things that I did and the damage that I caused to people. Whether, you know, it didn't matter. It didn't matter what gender, what age. I hurt a lot of people. You understand what I'm saying? I know that all of you haven't hurt as many people as I have, and I'm glad that you haven't. But you get the point that when we live our lives a certain way, we can hurt people and we can cause damage to people's lives and their souls, you know? And so now we're being exhorted by Paul to not to live that way, but instead to offer our lives as instruments of righteousness. So give me an example of that then, preacher. Sure. I mean, you know, wherever you are at work, whatever it is that you're doing, you're having a conversation with somebody. Well, I'm not at that level yet. That's fine. Nobody's trying to push you to do that either. You don't have to join the membership role. You don't have to, whatever else I said you didn't have to do. And you don't ever have to, ever, if you don't want to, tell somebody about Jesus. But if the real Jesus lives in you, I'm going to tell you right now, when the opportunity arises and the Holy Spirit starts nudging at you, you're going to want to open up your mouth and you're going to want to talk about Jesus. Because if you don't, you're going to feel convicted after you walk away. I'm telling you right now, if you're really a born-again Christian and you walk away after the Holy Spirit sets up that opportunity, you're going to feel conviction in your heart. What are you talking about? How do you know that? Because listen to me, for the first 5 years of my Christianity, even though I told a lot of people about Jesus, I can't tell you how many times I walked away feeling convicted because I didn't tell somebody about Jesus. But the point is that now you have an opportunity. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, however the Lord lays it on your heart, a door opens up and you let them know. No, man, I don't do that anymore. I used to feel so weird. You going to take your kids trick-or-treating? You know, and I hope I don't make you feel weird tonight, but if I do, then I wasn't my intent, okay? You going to take your kids trick-or-treating? I love when people do that now. I used to feel so weird. I was trying to find some kind of cool way to answer because I didn't want to seem like a separated outcast. Now I'm like, I'm loving it. You're going to ask me that? Oh, let's sit down and talk. You know, people been asking me lately, hey, doc, because I work at the clinic, you know. Hey, doc, you going parading? No, dude, Jesus changed my life, man. I don't go parading anymore. I don't go to Mardi Gras. But I will tell you this, because, see, I don't want to leave them thinking, oh, you think you're better than me. No.
Amen.
I said, let me tell you this. I'm going to be honest with you, dude. When I was in the world, I didn't even go to the parades. I was on the other side of town where all the people were doing all the park, you know, whatever the case. I was the worst when it came to that. I was a reveler. The other day I was in the gym, just I think it was on Monday, working out. And I heard this one girl telling this other girl, well, I just don't understand it. They go to church, but yet they still go to the parade. And I'm just confused. And I'm over here listening. I couldn't help it. My little radar caught that conversation. And I walked up and I said, you know, I know I'm butting in. And, you know, I know I was eavesdropping. But can you explain to me, what's the confusion about? Well, we're from North Carolina. And we've never seen anything like that. I said, well, don't be confused, because the confusion is that people down here, excuse me, and the preachers aren't explaining to the people that go to their churches that it's not okay, because Mardi Gras is the worship of the Greek god Bacchus, who's the god of wine and revelry. And that's why whenever you go to Mardi Gras, if you're not over there handing out tracts and telling people about Jesus, you're not supposed to be there. What are you talking about, preacher? Listen, I'm not trying to get you mad, but I'm going to keep on telling you this too. The name for the word church in the Greek is this, ecclesia. Ek out. Ecclesia, called. What does that mean? You're the called out ones. That means you don't go hang out with the world and partake and even validate what it is that they do. Oh, but I'm not doing all that. And when I bring, listen, I told you, God's not okay with it. He's not okay with us mixing ourselves with that. It doesn't make us any better than them. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul said in the book of Ephesians, and such were some of you. Don't forget where you were. Don't forget where God brought you out of. Don't look down your religious nose at other people just because they don't have a revelation that you have. But listen to me. Don't shrink back when your opportunity comes to take a stand for the gospel and to say, hey, Jesus changed me. And I know that there's certain things that are right. And there's certain. And if you really sit down and you talk about it, because I'll do it, man. I just doesn't have anything to do with my message, but I'll do it. I'm like, I'll try to take this position. I'll be like, dude, I just don't understand it. I mean, come on, let's just sit down and reason together for a second. So you're going to tell me, and listen, let's not be confused, because the church, the Catholic Church, embraced it.
Yeah.
I mean, is it not part of their religious ceremonial? Yeah, it's called Fat Tuesday. And basically what we're doing is we're going to go and we're going to live it up, bruh. It was called the buff gras, right? Where the big fatted calf, you're going to eat as much, you're going to gluttonize, you're going to drink as much as you want to, you're going to grab a hold of it. Look, that's why they ran around wearing masks. Because it elicits sexuality. Everywhere you turn around, everybody's going to get whatever it is that they want to get. And then the next thing you know, the next day, what's going to happen is you're going to walk over there to Stasio. Come on, Scott, you know it. And the first one you walk up to, you're going to freak out again. Even though it happens the same thing every year, the first one you see going to have that stuff painted on his head, and it's Ash Wednesday. And now we're mourning. Take the palm leaves or whatever, we burn them, and we're going to rub that stuff on our head, and now we're mourning. Listen to me. I don't mean to be ugly, but that is a lie from the pit of hell, and that will send people's soul to an eternal hell. Listen, you cannot sit there and live any old way you want to and then pretend that just by rubbing some ashes on your head, everything's okay. True mourning, you know where the whole ashes concept comes from? The Old Testament. It would say that whenever David was mourning because of his sin, his grievous sin, he would put sackcloth on his body. The Jewish man would put sackcloth on his body and rub ashes all over himself. And in a humid, hot environment, there can't be anything more uncomfortable than having sackcloth and ashes rubbed all over your body to remind you that you have failed God, and to make you emotionally distraught, and so that you would be reminded, Lord, please forgive me. I'm mourning. I'm broken. I don't want to continue to come against you.
Yes.
But now it's just kind of like, oh yeah, I did my little service.
And fast for 40 days.
Yeah, and then fast for 40 days. Eat shrimp. But anyway, let's not make fun of them too much. You get the point. Don't offer your members as instruments of unrighteousness. That's where we are. Offer your members as instruments of righteousness. Tell somebody about Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
All right. All right, now we're moving into Romans 7. We talked about verses 1 through 4 last week. And it said, know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law. Let's just go ahead and read all the way through verse 4. Know ye not, brethren, that I speak to them that know the law, how that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. The word dominion means lordship. I'm going to try to break this down, but let's just keep reading. For the woman which has a husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he lives. But if the husband is dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband. So then if while her husband lives, she be married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law, by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. Now, I got to be honest with you. It's kind of wordy, and it takes some time to break it down. But we did talk about it last week. For the longest time as a Christian, I thought this was a teaching on divorce. But the idea of divorce is nowhere in there. Really and truly, this is an analogy, an illustration that Paul is using. In chapter 6, we talked about how we died to sin. In chapter 7, we're talking about how we died to law. Remember how I told you whenever I first got saved and I went on the boat for 2 weeks, man, there was no dip, there was no asking girls to sleep with me, there was no drinking, there was none of that kind of stuff going on because I knew immediately that it was wrong. But then when I got off the boat and they said, the best thing that you ever did was give your heart to Jesus. Now you got some stuff you got to do. Without me understanding it, I thought that the way that I was going to live for God and gain strength from God was I was going to read the Bible every day. I was going to go to church every day. I was going to pray in tongues more every day. Oh, you didn't know I was filled with the Holy Ghost and I speak in other tongues. Yes, I do. And I'm not ashamed of that either. And I'll teach you about it if you hang around long enough. But this is the thing. That I was taught all these things were going to give me victory. I can remember one time I went to the preacher. God bless her soul. She was a great woman of God. I thank God for that woman because I'm telling you right now, I ran up to that altar. Amen. She preached the blood.
Amen.
But what I will say is this, is that I went up to her one day and I told her, because I don't know about you, but I wanted to be right. And I said, my mind is wrong. I got stuff going on in my head that ain't supposed to be there. Now, before, I was doing it physically. But now I got a movie playing in my mind. I'm in the pipe yard before I got my GED and went back to school and all this. It's been a long road. And I'm in the pipe yard and I got this stuff going on in my mind. And I know it's not supposed to be there. And I go to her and I say, what am I supposed to do to get rid of these thoughts in my mind? She said, you just need to pray in the spirit. To a Pentecostal, that means you need to pray in tongues more. And there is a scripture that talks about praying in the spirit, building up your most holy faith. But the way to victory is not through what you do in that sense. It's through what Jesus already did. Jesus destroyed the powers of darkness. Yes. Jesus destroyed the works of Satan. Jesus destroyed the power of demon spirits. And I didn't understand that. And I went to her and I was trying all of the things that I knew to do. But the reality of it was that it really wasn't working. And for the longest time, I just kind of gave in and just kind of let my mind, my thought life do whatever it was going to do. And I would always many times cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, my heart is wicked. My mind is not right. My thoughts are not right. And I would cry and I would ask God to forgive me. And he would. He's gracious. Amen. But I have to tell you that the problem was that I changed the object of my faith.
Yes.
I changed the object of my faith from Jesus Christ and him crucified, which allows grace to flow in your life.
Mm-hmm.
See, when you understand that in Christ, you're now righteous. Now the Holy Spirit can move in your life. He can now empower you and strengthen you. But whenever you begin to change God's plan, it wasn't God's plan for you to just
Amen.
Pray in tongues more whenever you're having an attack by the devil. Don't get me wrong. You can pray in tongues and it's going to remind you of the darling of heaven that died for you. Sometimes, listen, when I'm going through a trial, I still do it today, man. Next thing you know, I'm praying in the spirit And I'm praying in the spirit for quite a while. And you know what? I do. I start to feel strengthened. But I'm being reminded where to keep my faith. Amen? Amen. And when I read the scriptures, what I'm getting out of the scriptures is they're always pointing me back to the plan of God. Amen. Jesus Christ and Him crucified. When I go to church, I hope I go to a church where I'm constantly being reminded of the plan of God. Amen? Whenever I pray the scripture, which I'm always reminded. Lord, thank you for sending your Son that through the veil which was his flesh was ripped, amen, and now I have entree, a new and living way to get into the presence of God through the veil which is his flesh. He died so that I could have access to grace. And so that's what Romans 7 is about. You died in Romans 6 to sin. In Romans 7, it's teaching us that we're dying to law. Now, we're talking about in the first four verses an analogy or an illustration of marriage. Now, let's go back to it for a second. It says, "Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them to know the law, how that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives." So what are you saying, preacher? Are you saying that until I die, then the law is my Lord? Well, it's not talking about your physical death. See, he says that this woman, as long as her husband is alive, she's under the law of marriage to her husband. But if he dies, it changes the relationship. She's no longer under the law of her husband. So when a death took place in that relationship, then now there was a change in the relationship between them. Does that make sense? And now it says in verse 4, "Wherefore, my brethren, you also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ." So the same way you died to sin, when you put faith in Christ, you were placed in Him, baptized in His death, and baptized in His resurrection. Right here, you died to sin. It's also saying you also died to the law. You died to the law's dominion over you. It's no longer your law, your Lord. You're not being judged by the law. Jesus took your judgment upon you. Does that make sense? All right. So you need to understand that as we move forward. Now look at verse 5. It says, "For when we were in the flesh." Now I have to tell you that the word flesh can be utilized in many ways in the scriptures. You know, if anybody actually watches this video, this would be a good one that it'd probably take you about, you ought to probably watch it 3 or 4 times. You ought to press pause. You ought to get a notebook. You ought to slow down and read the scriptures. I mean, if you really want to learn. But the word flesh can be utilized in at least 3 different ways. Number one, it can describe physical birth. Physical birth. Well, what are you talking about? Well, whenever Jesus, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, "In the fullness of time, God sent forth His Son, born it's in the flesh, born of a woman." Well, Jesus didn't have any sin in Him. And so what that scripture is talking about when it's talking about the flesh, it's talking about His physical body. Amen? So sometimes in the scriptures, it can talk about your physical birth or your physical body, if you will. But sometimes it talks about the sinful nature that's in man. And so that's what that's talking about. Your first birth. And it's connecting it not just to physical birth, but to the sinful aspect of your first birth, if that makes sense. But it can also describe a believer's life. You can also walk in the flesh as a believer. Many times, now what that's descriptive of is, once again, and it's very important that we understand this because it has everything to do with Romans chapter 7. You walking in the flesh could really be a couple of different things. Really, walking after the flesh means you're attempting to live for God and earn your righteousness with God through what you do rather than through what He did. When you do that, you're walking after the flesh. I'm about to break down what that can look like here in a second. When you walk after the flesh, you begin to produce lusts of the flesh. Now, you can also just straight up, if you see something that you like and something that you want, go get it, and you can cause the same effect to happen. But in that case, it's a little bit different because now you know what you're doing. In reality, for the longest time in my Christianity, I didn't even know what I was doing. I would feel bad because my mind was all messed up. I was looking at stuff I shouldn't look at, doing stuff I shouldn't do. I'd feel horrible. I'd come up to the altar. I'd fall on, I don't know if I fell on my knees a lot, but I'd cry out to God, "Lord, please, please forgive me. Please set me free." I'd feel better. And then I'd go right back into the cycle like a dog chasing its tail of putting my faith in what I was doing. Read more, go to church more, and all of these things, thinking that was making me righteous, that in and of itself is sin. It's like walking in the flesh. Does that make sense what I'm trying to say? Your performance, your flesh, your physical strength. Is everybody getting that? Y'all okay with this? All right. So the believer can do it also by walking in his own strength. Own strength. All right. So, but in this case, what we're talking about in verse 5 is we're talking about the fact that when we were in the flesh is talking about pre-conversion. Does that make sense? Before you gave your heart to Christ, pre-conversion, you were walking in the flesh. You were in your sinful nature was alive and well, and you didn't even know any better because you had never been saved before. Y'all with me? Yeah. All right. For when we were in the flesh, when we were in our first birth of Adam, we could say, the motions, that word was Old King James for emotions, the impulses. You know what you feel when you feel an emotion? Okay, the impulses or the emotions of sin, which were by the law. See, the thing of it is that you don't have to be a Christian, you don't have to be a Jew. If you can give any kind of a law or any kind of a rule to anybody, and some of y'all know what I'm talking about, don't touch that, don't do that. The first thing that you want to do is you want to do it. You want to, you, even if you didn't want to do it right then, the fact of the matter is if you wait long enough and you keep looking at that thing and boy, I tell you, man, if I just keep looking, I keep thinking about it. And then, I mean, I just wonder what it feel like if I just touched it a little bit. I mean, would it taste though? How's it smell? And then, you know, it's like, and next thing you know, you're being driven to go touch it. And you're being driven to grab a hold of it. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? And so that's what it's saying. It's saying that when we were in our sinful nature, the emotions or impulses of sin, which were by the law caused these things to come alive, all right? Which were by the law, did work in our members, gave energy. The law gave sin energy in our members or our body parts to bring forth fruit unto death. So this is talking about before Jesus. Amen? All right, now in verse 6, but now we are delivered. I'm trying to make a big point right here. I probably went way too long on the front end. I hope I don't lose y'all because we're about to get real wordy. And I meant to tell y'all to put your thinking cap on before we even started, okay? Because we're really going to have to think here in a minute, all right? Is that okay?
Amen.
That we get challenged to think? I hope so. All right, verse 6. This is a transition point. A pivot point. We're moving from pre-conversion to post-conversion. All right? It says right here, but now we are delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. You can turn, if you have your Bible, to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. Well, I'm going to kind of quote to you or paraphrase a scripture out of Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah was a prophet that was probably about 600 years before the birth of Jesus. And the Holy Spirit told Jeremiah that there was coming a day when he was going to have a new covenant with his people. And in the new covenant, he was going to write his law on the inside of their hearts. It wasn't going to be written on tablets of stone, but on the inside of their hearts. And so in 2 Corinthians 3, it says, verse 2, you are our epistle, that's a letter, written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as you are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And so the idea is that the tables, it's a fleshly table of the heart. It's okay. Hey, we had that happen to us the other day too, so it's all good. All right, so the point that I'm trying to make is that in the new covenant, that it was going to be written on the heart. Amen? And so the law of God was going to be written on the inside of the heart. And so we, but now we are delivered from the law, being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not the oldness of the letter. So in other words, it's not just a bunch of laws and rules and regulations that we're following, but that whenever we give our heart to Jesus, the Holy Spirit, who wrote the law, now lives in our heart, and He's telling us beforehand, before we ever did it, what's right, what's wrong, and He's leading and guiding us in the right direction.
Amen.
And He desires for us to hear His voice. And so, but what the main point I want you to know is that from verse 5 to verse 6, we transitioned from before Christ to after Christ. You see that part right there? But now we are delivered. Does that not sound to you that we're moving into salvation now?
Amen. All right.
Then it says in verse 7, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. See, Paul wants you and I to know that the law is not the problem. The law came from God. The law is spiritual. Now, I want to, right now, I already want to just try to plant a thought in your mind. Is reading your Bible a sin?
If you make a law out of it.
But in essence, the reading of the Bible shouldn't be a sin, right?
Amen.
Praying to God shouldn't be a sin, right? Going to church shouldn't be a sin.
Amen.
Reading your Bible is not the problem. Going to church isn't the problem. Praying isn't the problem. The problem is us. Paul ends up saying later on in Romans chapter 7, the law is spiritual. I'm carnal. I'm the one that's sold under sin. And so what ends up happening, and I don't want to get ahead of myself, but we start to move towards rituals and legalism, and we turn something spiritual and godly into something that actually becomes, it turns into sin in our lives.
Amen.
Because we're putting our faith in our own performance rather than putting our faith in His performance, okay? And so it says right here, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law. For I had not known lust except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. Now it says in verse 8, but sin, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence, for without the law, sin was dead. Now, this is where I've had multiple conversations with Baptist preachers, and I've read commentaries behind Baptist commentators. I was very pleased when I reminded myself of Brother Kenneth Wiest, who was a Greek scholar, who also was a teacher at Moody Bible College. And I reviewed his work today, and I remembered it from the past, that he went in a completely different way. He didn't follow the thoughts of all of his Baptist predecessors. He studied the text, and he came to the conclusion that this is Paul post-conversion. He's talking about himself. Paul is using himself as an example. I want to make this clear. We don't have time to break down the narrative story behind it, but real quick, I'll just explain to you that when the Apostle Paul got saved on the road to Damascus, right? He was going to get letters to throw Christians into prison and to have them killed. He was blinded. A servant named Ananias laid hands on him. The Bible says scales fell from his eyes. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. The Bible says he straightway, meaning he immediately preached Jesus in the synagogue. Next thing you know, people were questioning whether or not, what's the deal? This is the guy that used to persecute us. He was killing Christians. He was causing Christians to be put in prison. And so people started to come against him. Things started getting hot. After a period of time, he separated himself for at least 3 years. The book of Galatians talks about that. After 3 years, he went and talked to Peter for a little bit. He's already, after 3 years, gaining revelation that some people don't have. Some people believe that he was separated for anywhere from 7 to 10 years from the rest of all of the disciples that are doing ministry after Jesus has gone on in the book of Acts is taking place. And then ultimately, they hear that Paul is doing a work and they send Barnabas to go get Paul. But what I'm trying to tell you is that, at least in my studies, what I have come to the conclusion is that in that 10-year period somewhere, The same thing that happened to Matt Hebert, and the same thing that happened to any Christian that's been in the faith for any length of time and is willing to admit it, happened to the Apostle Paul in that time frame whenever he began to embrace a system of law, commandments, self-performance, and adding that to his faith in Christ. And what it did was it caused the sinful nature to regain power in his life and began to cause him to find himself in a place where he could not do the things that he wanted to do. Now, I'm just letting you know, that's the mighty Apostle Paul. We're not going to get to all that tonight, but it's right here in Romans chapter 7. And so what I want to encourage you with is this. You might find yourself sometimes struggling with some things. You might find yourself sometimes where sin seems more powerful than your faith. But I got good news for you. The gospel says, hallelujah, that the mightiest of the apostles went through the same thing that you may be going through. And that if God got him through, God will get you through. But we need, hallelujah, but we need to understand. All right? And so he says, but sin taking occasion by the commandment. Now, the word occasion there, it means a starting point. It's like a base of operations. You remember when America bombed Iraq in Desert Storm? They used Kuwait as a base of operations. Sin uses the law as a way to get in.
That's good.
See, you can sit here and you're like cruising along. And let me tell you something. You're like dead meat on the side of the road, buddy, if you got a legalistic preacher. You're good luck with your walk. I'm just going to be perfectly honest with you. I don't mean to be ugly, but good luck with that, because I'm just going to be perfectly, look, if they're preaching a bunch of legalism and they're preaching performance and it's all about you, I went to a church for so long and they would preach a few scriptures and then at the very end, this was the answer. And if you want to do it for the Lord, this is what you got to do. You got to read every day. You got to go to church 3 times a week. You got to witness to at least one person a day and you got to do this, and that's going to give you your victory. No, it's not, sir. That's not how it works. What you do every day is you determine to keep your faith focused in God's plan. The old man died, a new man's resurrected, and you keep your faith squarely placed in the instrument of death known as Calvary, where your old man died, and the place where your new man was resurrected to newness of life. And as you continue to believe that on a regular basis, now grace is flowing in your life. Now you're getting hungry for the Word of God. You're getting hungry for Jesus. And let me tell you something. Whenever your heart is full of Jesus, He's got to come out. You're going to want to tell somebody about Him. You're going to start caring less if they think you're crazy. And you're going to start caring more about pleasing the one that loved you enough to die for you. That just sounds right. Because I know, I'm telling you, I was over there trying in my own strength. Oh, I got to tell one today. What am I going to do? Oh, man, it was so hard. I remember being in school, man, at Nichols, wearing them t-shirts and trying to wear my Christian t-shirts and just whatever. I mean, I would try everything I knew to do. And sometimes, man, I was just so nervous. But you know what? That's okay. Hey, at least we were doing it, right? Yeah. And the more you do it, the more you get used to it. Amen. And now I just, man, I'm just grateful that it's just praise Jesus that I can just tell somebody about Jesus, man. I know that this isn't anything to do with the message, but I mean, look, if they can talk about what they talk about, I want to talk about Jesus. Amen? I love Him. I hope you love Him. I know you do. All right, so sin takes the occasion by the commandment and wrought in me, produced in me all manner of concupiscence. That word means lust. It means lust was raging in me. For without the law, sin was dead. Now look at this in verse 9. This is why I had to really try to explain a lot of that stuff about death and all that stuff before, because this is where it really, you got to put your thinking cap. For I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. We're going to stop after this verse, okay? I wasn't done. I had some other stuff I was going to talk about, but I'm going to be kind. All right. I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. Now, I read behind a lot of Baptist scholars on this, and what their take on it is that they're talking about Paul at an age when he would not have understood the law, and that when he came to an age when he understood the law, that's whenever sin gained power in his life, all right? But number one, the first problem with that is in verse 5, where from verse 5 to 6, where we transition from pre-conversion to post-conversion, right? Paul, he was originally talking about the fact that we were dead in sin, and then he started talking about the fact that now we've been delivered from the power of sin. That was number one. Number two, when we go back to the analogy, he talked about in verses 1 through 4, what did he talk about? He talked about a death taking place in Christ that changed our relationship to the law. So what I'm presenting to you is that really what the Apostle Paul is saying here is, I was alive once without the law. I died in Christ to both sin and the law. I resurrected to newness of life. I was alive without the law, but then the commandment came. In other words, I added law to my faith. All right? I don't know what Paul added to his faith, but you got to understand that as a Jew, all he knew was the law. And so if in his mind, he would have thought, I have Jesus now, but now if I don't eat pork, I'm just using that as an example, I'll be even more holy. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
If I don't eat pork, I'll be even more holy. If I keep the Sabbath, I'll be even more holy. If I do this, I'll even be better. If I do this over here, I'll really please God. If I work hard enough at it, then guess what? God's going to bless me with victory. And so while you and I won't go back to the Ten Commandments, or we won't say, oh, I'm better than eating pork, we won't do that. But what the church around us will do is, it'll try to say, oh, you gave your heart to Jesus, but you're still struggling with some stuff. Well, let's go ahead and create a program like Rick Warren did. I know you're not supposed to call their names out, but I like to do that. Rick Warren created his own little program. It's called Celebrate Recovery. And so what they do is they take a mixture of what the world's doing, okay, with AA and all these other kinds of things, and then they put some scripture on it, and they mix the two together, and they act like, now we got it. We got the answer to set you free. No, sir, no, you don't. What you did was you created a performance-based program. You're saying Jesus is your higher power, but you're not doing this. You're not keeping your faith in what Christ has done, and now you're creating a completely different system. You're going to work a program, or you're going to go to church more, or you're going to pray more, or you're going to pray in tongues more. You're going to do all of this stuff. Now everything is built upon self-performance instead of His performance, and I'm going to tell you, it's hard enough to live for Jesus as it is, but if you don't even have the right object of faith in your life, can anybody agree with me on that? Amen?
Yeah.
All right. So that's number two. It says, I wanted to just see that. I was alive once I had died in Christ. I was no longer under the dominion of the law. But when the commandment came, sin revived. Now, I just want to talk to you real quick about the word revived, and then I'm going to shut it down. The word revived in the Greek language is anasia. And that's not what's important. What's important is it's only used twice in the whole Greek, in the whole New Testament. Only twice is that word revived used. As a matter of fact, if you have your Bibles, let's turn to Romans chapter 14, verse 9. And let's look at that scripture real quick. Now, just remember, I'm trying to explain to you. I'm not picking on anybody, but I'm trying to explain to you that scholars and commentators have said that this was before Paul was even grown up, so therefore it was before his conversion. What I'm trying to tell you is, no, this is after Paul's conversion that the sinful nature revived.
Amen.
Okay? Now, I know you're used to seeing paintings where he's got this halo on his head, but you got to understand that right there is satanic anyway. That's worship of the sun god. And I don't mean to get into all that, but my point is, we have had a wrong visual of what the disciples were. The disciples were a mighty men of God. Amen. They gave their lives for the cause of Christ. Peter denied Jesus. You remember that? Peter denied Jesus 3 times. You get my point? I don't know about you, but when I was a child, I saw those little halos behind their head. I just, oh man, they never did anything wrong. No, they were human beings that were learning how to walk with Jesus and learning how to experience grace just like you and I are today. So look at chapter 14, verse 9. For to this end, Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. Now, in that context, what does the word revived mean to you? I mean, I'm not going to. If you want to answer, you can. I'm not going to make you, but I'm just trying to make you think. What does the word revive mean to you? Does it mean that... What's that? Does it mean... So, well, I'm going to just tell you the answer. What it means is that he was alive, he died, and he revived, right? He was, it's not, but he definitely died, right? But he came back to life. The word literally means to regain life, to come alive again. And it's the same exact word in that verse as it is in this verse. So now when we go back to Romans chapter 7, verse 9, and he says, I was alive without the law once. Once again, according to the verses 1 through 4 analogy, we died in Christ. He's a Christian now. He added law to his faith. Sin, the power of sin that was lying dormant and that relationship was dead, according to Romans 6, now revived, came back to life, gained strength, and he began to die spiritually. The word's only used twice. You can't say that this was him as a child and it had never come to life before, because if that was the case, the Holy Spirit would have used a different word to describe it.
Amen.
He wouldn't have used revived as though it were something that had died.
Amen.
And come back to life. Amen.